Remember therefore how thou hast received and heard, and hold fast and repent. If therefore thou shalt not watch, I will come on thee as a thief. And thou shalt not know what hour I will come upon thee. The Lord of that servant shall come in a day when he looketh not for him, and in an hour that he is not aware of, and shall cut him asunder, and appoint him his portion with the hypocrites. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth.
Greetings, fellow brothers and sisters. This teaching is not a thus saith the Lord teaching regarding the timeline, nor do I idolize numbers. These teachings will only make sense to those who understands what the abomination is. The timeline on this teaching is a possible conjecture to help refine exactly what time frame we are currently in within that last 3.5 years. I believe that the great and dreadful day of the Lord as a thief in the night is a dreadful day for each person that has taken the abomination. I will use ample of verses to elaborate. God has graciously given all of us a 1,290-day countdown and a 1,335-day countdown to help guide us all. We can confidently know that Daniel 12:11 was written for our time because Jesus was asked the question in Matthew 24, what will be the sign of your coming and the end of the age? Jesus replies, Matthew 24:15, when ye therefore shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet stand in the holy place, whoever readeth, let him understand. In other words, when you shall see the rolling out of the abomination literally with your eyes, the abomination that makes people desolate. Desolate, which means to empty or divorce God at the genetic level. Jesus continues to say, spoken of by Daniel the prophet. Here we see Jesus elaborating on what Daniel the prophet said. We carry on in the verse. Stand in the holy place. The abomination or pattern is now standing in the temples of those whose genetics were ripe for salvation. So let's see what verse Jesus was elaborating on regarding what Daniel said. Daniel 12:11, and from the time that the daily sacrifice shall be taken away, the abomination that maketh desolate set up, there shall be 1,290 days. Again, Jesus was asked the question, what will be the sign of your coming and the end of the age? Christ was elaborating on what Daniel 12:11 said. So this confirms, first of all, that Daniel 12:11 was prophesied for our days now, the end of the age, just as Jesus said. Note when Jesus said, when ye therefore shall see the abomination, and Daniel says, and from the time. So when we see people lining up to receive the abomination, and from that time, the desolation time will mark the beginning of the 1,290-day countdown. But before we get into all this, it is very important to understand Matthew 24, verse 36. I have taught this subject on part 4, but this time round, I will elaborate a little more on it. But of the day and hour knoweth no man, no, not the angels of heaven, but my Father only. Matthew 24 is riddled with verses regarding the abomination. So this gives us an indication that Matthew 24, verse 36, is talking about the abomination, which I will break down and confirm. Every person that received the abomination did not know the day or hour or minute or even the second. No, not even the angels, only the Father knows the exact day and hour of the timing of every single person's desolation. that was caused by the abomination, because it was God himself that came upon them like a thief. Matthew 24 verse 50, the Lord of that servant shall come in a day when he looketh not for him, and in an hour that he is not aware of. Did Bob know the hour or day when he decided to roll up them sleeves? Did he know that it was inevitable when he took the abomination, which in turn would make him desolate? No, he didn't. If he did know, he would have stayed right away from the abomination. Matthew 24 verse 43, but know this, that if the good man of the house had known in what watch the thief would come, he would have watched and would not have suffered his house to be broken up. But of that day and hour knoweth no man, no, not the angels of heaven, but my Father only. This is not talking about the rapture. It is the Father, the Lord of that clueless servant, who was delaying Christ's coming, who said, we have more time, who said that this was not the abomination, who said this abomination was a precursor, who ultimately said that his coming is not at hand. This clueless person was originally patterned to God and genetically ripe for salvation. It was his creator that had cut him asunder when he received the abomination. Let's go to the book of Matthew 24 verse 40 to 41. Then shall two be in the field, and one shall be taken and the other left. Two women shall be grinding at the mill, the one shall be taken and the other left. Many refer to this verse as the rapture. This is not the rapture. The ones taken first are those who received the abomination. Let's go to the book of Matthew 13 verse 30. Let both grow together unto the harvest. And in the time of harvest I will say to the reapers, gather ye together first the tares, and bind them into bundles to burn them. But gather the wheat unto my barn. So the ones being taken first is not the rapture. The ones taken first are those who took the abomination. For a complete breakdown regarding the wheat and the tare parable, watch my part one video. Jesus is coming soon, or is the coming of Jesus already here? Now compare the great flood, Sodom and Gomorrah, and the days of Egypt as his coming in those days. Because I'm going to compare those days to these days, and I can use any of these scenarios, but for now, I'll use the days of Egypt. Let's turn to the book of Exodus 12, 12 to 13. For I will pass through the land of Egypt this night, and will smite all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast, against all the gods of Egypt, for I will execute judgment. I am the Lord. And the blood shall be to you for a token upon the houses where ye are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you, and the plague shall not be upon you to destroy you when I smite the land of Egypt. Who came as a thief upon Egypt? It says, I will pass through the land of Egypt this night. And it says, I will execute. I am the Lord. God came upon Egypt as a plague to destroy every firstborn whose houses did not bear the lamb's blood on their doorposts. God was only a thief unto those who didn't have the lamb's blood. But God was not a thief unto those who did have the lamb's blood. Note also when it says, and the blood shall be to you for a token upon the houses where ye are. This means that the blood of those they care for it is upon the heads of each household or parent who are ultimately responsible for those who live in their care. Ask yourself this question. Those that are currently in our care, why didn't they take the abomination? Because we parents knew it was the abomination and stood in the gap for them. Revelation 3:10, because thou hast kept the word of my patience, I also will keep thee from the hour of temptation, which shall come upon all the world to try them that dwell upon the earth. Many succumb to the temptation to hold on to their lives, and just like the days of Egypt, God kept us safe from his wrath. The first wave of God's wrath overpassed you and I, but woe, another wave cometh quickly. In the days of Egypt, God himself came as a plague. So is it possible that his coming in these last days has come as a plague or a pestilence or a toxin? Let's go to the book of Revelation chapter 6 verse 2. And I saw and behold a white horse, and he that sat on him had a bow, and a crown was given unto him, and he went forth conquering and to conquer. Now the Greek word for bow means toxin. The toxin is in the Trojan horse abomination. It's obviously clear that God himself described himself as a plague upon Egypt. Now let's find a collection of verses to confirm other plagues from God Almighty. Let's turn to the book of Numbers 12 verse 9. And the anger of the Lord was kindled against them, and he departed. And the cloud departed from off the tabernacle, and behold, Miriam became leprous, white as snow. And Aaron looked upon Miriam, and behold, she was leprous. Okay, now note here, God departed from the tabernacle. Now compare this with the temples of those who took the abomination. Also note, when the cloud departed from the tabernacle, God gave Miriam leprosy. We can compare the scenario to those who took the abomination that made them desolate. God's Spirit left them bare, set up for a time when God seems fit to pour the vile, the grievous sore clouds into those that lay empty. In the book of 2 Kings, verse 19 to 35, and it came to pass that night that the angel of the Lord went out and smote in the camp of the Assyrians, and 185,000. And when they arose early in the morning, behold, they were all dead corpses. The angel of God killed 185,000 Assyrians. No doubt that God used pestilence here. In the book of 2 Samuel 24:15, so the Lord sent a pestilence upon Israel from the morning even to the time appointed. And there died of the people from Dan even to Beersheba 70,000 men. In the book of Numbers 11:33, and while the flesh was yet between their teeth, it was chewed. And the wrath of the Lord was kindled against the people, and the Lord smote the people with a very great plague. Okay, I've quoted five out of many more events to prove that God himself, whether by angel or not, it was ultimately God that brought pestilence and plagues upon those who kindled his anger. Is it possible that God's previous plague judgments are similar to the same plague judgments within the abomination? But in this case, the abomination today cuts asunder. And if this is to be in fact true, and if God himself came down upon Egypt as a destroyer and plague, has Jesus' second coming with wrath, as a destroyer and as a thief, already started within the temple of those who took the abomination, upon a world that has become like Egypt? Every eye will see him in the clouds. Revelation 1:7, behold, he cometh with clouds, and every eye shall see him, and they also which pierced him, and all kindreds of the earth shall wail because of him, even so, amen. Is his second coming in this verse literal, or is it symbolic? First, let's have a look into God's previous wraths regarding the key word cloud to understand somewhat his coming in the clouds in these days. Let's go to the book of Ezekiel 30 verse 3 to 4. For the day is near, even the day of the Lord is near, a cloudy day. It shall be the time of the heathen, and the sword shall come upon Egypt, and great pain shall be in Ethiopia, when the slain shall fall in Egypt, and they shall take away her multitude, and her foundation shall be broken down. Cloudy day. Joel 2:1-2. Blow ye the trumpet in Zion, and sound an alarm in my holy mountain. Let all the inhabitants of the land tremble, for the day of the Lord cometh. For it is nigh at hand, a day of darkness and of gloominess. Here we go, a day of clouds, and of thick darkness, as the morning spread upon the mountains, a great people, and a strong. They have not been ever the like, neither shall be any more after it, even to the years of many generations. Zephaniah 1 verse 15, that day is a day of wrath, a day of trouble and distress, a day of wasteness and desolation, a day of darkness and gloominess, a day of clouds and thick darkness. Is not the abomination God's wrath? Yes, it is. Read Revelations chapter 14 verse 9 to 10. We can also confidently say that God himself came as a thief, as a plague and destroyer, like a cloud, to judge the land of Egypt. So will God's return in a similar fashion. Now let's have a look in the New Testament regarding the word cloud. What we really need to find is a verse that specifically ties his cloud judgments with the word reaping, which is the abomination. Let's go to the book of Matthew 24, verse 30. And then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven, and then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn, and thou shalt see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven, with power and great glory. Did not the abomination shake everything that can be shaken? Revelation chapter 1 verse 7, behold, he cometh with clouds, and every eye shall see him, and they also which pierced him, and all kindreds of the earth shall wail because of him. Even so, amen. Now, let's go to the book of Revelation 14, verse 14 to 19. And I looked, and behold, a white cloud, and upon the cloud one sat like unto the Son of Man, having on his head a golden crown, and in his hand a sharp sickle. And another angel came out of the temple, crying with a loud voice to him that sat on the cloud, thrust in thy sickle and reap. For the time is come for thee to reap, for the harvest of the earth is ripe. And he that sat on the cloud thrust in his sickle on the earth, and the earth was reaped. And another angel came out of the temple which is in heaven, he also having a sharp sickle. And another angel came out from the altar, which had power over fire. He cried with a loud cry to him that had the sharp sickle, saying, thrust in thy sharp sickle, and gather the clusters of the vine of the earth. For her grapes are fully ripe. And the angel thrust in his sickle into the earth, and gathered the vine of the earth, and cast it into the great winepress of the wrath of God. Okay, we found a verse that specifically ties together the word cloud and reaping. Is not the reaping cloud reaping now with the abomination? The white cloud is given the order to reap the harvest, to gather the clusters of the earth. Remember who gave the order to gather first the tares to burn? So the clusters and tares are the same. Let's go back to the book of Matthew 13, verse 30 again. Let both grow unto the harvest, and in the time of harvest I will say to the reapers, gather ye together first the tares, and bind them in bundles to burn them, but gather the wheat into my barn. It was Jesus who gave the order to the reapers to gather first the tares to burn. And it was Jesus who was described as one who sat upon the cloud, who also gave the order to gather the clusters of the earth and to cast them into the great winepress of the wrath of God. In the book of Matthew 15:13, but he answered and said, every plant which my heavenly Father hath not planted shall be rooted up. It's harvest time. God is weeding his garden. The tares or clusters are no longer a wheat or human anymore. Therefore, they are rooted up first. So when the Bible says that every eye will see him coming in the clouds, is it symbolic by saying that every single person since 2020 will experience the great harvesting? Let's go to the book of Hebrews 12 verse 1. Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us. The world is riddled with witnesses who witnessed these times. Now let's look at it from a different view regarding his second coming as a thief, which is compared to his coming in the clouds. In the book of Matthew 24, verse 37 to 39, but as the days of Noah were, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. For as in the days that were before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, until the day that Noah entered into the ark and knew not until the flood came and took them all away, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. And just like the days of Noah, clueless servants these days did not know when the coming of the Son of Man began. So we already touched bases on Matthew 24 verse 40 to 42, talking about two will be working in the field and one will be taken and the other one left. And the ones taken first are the tares or the clusters of the vine of the earth. Now let's go to the book of Matthew 24 verse 43. But know this, that if the good man of the house had known in what watch the thief would come, he would have watched and would not have suffered his house to be broken up. Okay? So if the good man of the house, of his temple, had known that the abomination is at hand, or if the good man had of known that the second coming of Christ has come like a thief, he would not have taken the plague of abomination and would not have suffered his temple, his genetics, to be broken up. Just like God's coming upon the days of Egypt, upon those who did not bear the lamb's blood on their doorposts, is it possible Jesus' coming came upon those who took the abomination? The book of Matthew 24, verse 44, therefore be ye also ready, for in such an hour as you think not, the Son of Man cometh. Those who took the abomination did not know that the Son of Man, listen to the language here, did not know that the Son of Man cometh upon him. Okay? In Matthew 24, verse 46, blessed is that servant whom his Lord, when he cometh, shall find so doing. In other words, blessed is that servant that understands that the abomination is the mark, and understands that the abomination is the coming of the Lord. And when his coming encompassed the whole world and took those who took the abomination, we were blessed because, like the days of Egypt, he overpassed you and I. The book of Matthew 24, 48 to 51. But if that evil servant shall say in his heart, my Lord delayeth his coming, But if that evil servant had of known in what watch the thief would come, who was coming as a thief, he would have watched and would not have suffered his house, his temple, his genetics to be altered. In the book of Matthew 24:50-51, the Lord of that servant shall come in a day when he looketh not for him, and in an hour that he is not aware of, and shall cut him asunder, and appoint his portion with the hypocrites. There shall be weeping and gnashings of teeth. So the Lord of that servant, because originally this clueless servant was the offspring of what God created, the Lord of that servant shall come upon this clueless servant in a day when he looketh not for him, and in an hour that he is not aware of. Here we see again and again the coming of the Lord shall cut this clueless servant asunder. Cut asunder means what God puts together, let no man separate. This is confirmation that man alone cannot cut asunder what God has put together, because it clearly states here that the Lord of that servant shall come in a day when he looketh not for him, and in an hour that he is not aware of. The Lord shall cut him asunder. So when we currently say that we await the coming of the Lord, is it possible that the coming of the Lord, or the great day of the Lord as a thief, has already started within the Trojan horse, cloud of abomination? Let's get some more verses. Let's go to the book of Revelation 3 verse 3. Remember therefore how thou hast received and heard, and hold fast and repent. If therefore thou shalt not watch, I will come on thee as a thief. I will come on thee as a thief, and thou shalt not know what hour I will come upon thee. Revelation 16:15, behold, I come as a thief. I come as a thief. Blessed is he that watcheth and keepeth his garments, lest he walk naked and they see his shame. 1 Thessalonians 5:1, but of the times and seasons, brethren, you have no need that I write unto you, for yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord, the day of the Lord, so cometh as a thief in the night. Okay, so it says the day of the Lord, so it comes as a thief. On a day and hour, no man and no angel, only the Father knows the day and hour of each and every person's desolation. In the book of Revelation 6:17, for the great day of his wrath is come, and who shall be able to stand? For the great day of his wrath has come. Come as in past tense. Who was able to endure the increasing pressures regarding the abomination? Did not the coming of the Lord's wrath come like a thief upon those who scoffed at Noah? Did not the coming of the Lord's wrath come upon Sodom and Gomorrah as a thief? Did not the coming of the Lord's wrath come like a thief upon Egypt, upon those who did not bear the Lamb's blood on their doorposts? And did not the coming of the Lord's wrath come like a thief upon those who took the abomination these days? But God's wrath did not come like a thief upon Noah. God's wrath did not come like a thief upon Lot. God's wrath did not come like a thief upon those who had the Lamb's blood on their doorposts, nor did his wrath come upon those who refused the abomination. In the book of 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 verse 4, it says, but ye brethren are not in darkness, that that day should overtake you as a thief. Really sink that in. In the book of Revelation 15:2, and I saw as it were a sea of glass mingled with fire, and them that had gotten the victory over the beast and over his image and over his mark and over the number of his name, stand on the sea of glass, having the harps of God. I've presented over 10 solid verses that Jesus Christ's coming as a thief came upon those who took the abomination. And his coming, or the pressures surrounding the abomination, will only intensify. Now the next question is, what part does Lucifer play in all this? Let's look at the agreement God had with Lucifer regarding Job. In the book of Job, chapter 1, verse 6 to 12, now there was a day when the sons of God, or the Benihai Elohim, came to present themselves before the Lord. And Satan came also among them. And the Lord said unto Satan, whence comest thou? Then Satan answered the Lord and said, from going to and fro in the earth, and from walking up and down in it. And the Lord said unto Satan, hast thou considered my servant Job, that there is none like him in the earth, a perfect and upright man, one that feareth God, escheweth evil? Then Satan answered the Lord and said, doth Job fear God for naught? In other words, would Job still fear God if Job was stripped from everything? Verse 10, hast not thou made an hedge about him and about his house and about all that he hath on every side? Thou hast blessed the work of his hands, and his substance is increased in the land. Verse 11, but put forth thine hand now, and touch all that he hath, and he will curse thee to thy face. In other words, Satan says to God, if you put forth thine hand now, and strip Job to naught, Job will curse thee to your face. And the Lord said unto Satan, behold, all that he hath is in thy power. Only upon himself put not forth thine hand. So Satan went forth from the presence of the Lord. And when we go to the book of Job, chapter 2, verse 6, and the Lord said unto Satan, behold, he is in thine hand, but save his life. Okay? The Lord said unto Satan, behold, Job is in thine hand to strip him of all that he has, but my only condition is, do not kill him. Now Job was blessed with 7 sons and 3 daughters, 3,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 oxen, 500 asses, and a very blessed household, and was the greatest of men in the east. By the permission of God, Satan took away all Job's animals. By the permission of God, Satan took away Job's children. And Job's wife cursed God. By the permission of God, Satan smote Job with boils. And by the permission of God, Satan stripped Job's popularity, who once was the greatest of men in the east. Although everything was taken from Job, he still had God, who was his everything. Regardless of losing his family, friends, and all that he had, the one he feared most to lose was his relationship with God. In the book of Job 1:21-22, and said, naked come I out of my mother's womb, and naked shall I return thither. The Lord gave, and the Lord hath taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. In all this, Job sinned not, nor charged God foolishly. You see, Lucifer cannot do anything without God giving the okay to do it. Consider the agreement Lucifer had with God regarding Job. God allowed Lucifer to strip him bare to see if Job really did love God. So likewise towards every single one of us in these days. We can compare the stripping away from Job to these days regarding the abomination. Job ultimately had a choice to denounce God to save what he could before everything was stripped away from him. Likewise, these days, many denounce God to keep their comfortable lifestyles by taking the abomination, and many of us who did not denounce God simply chose God over all that we had. whether it be a job, travel, kids, family and friends, and the list goes on. In the book of Matthew 19:29, "And everyone that hath forsaken houses, or brethren, or sisters, or father, or mother, or wife, or children, or lands, for my name's sake shall receive a hundredfold, and shall inherit everlasting life." In the book of Revelation 12:11, "And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb, and by the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives unto the death." Everything that conspired around the pandemic, mandates and restrictions, God gave the green light to do so. It is comforting that God is totally in control here. Symbolically, the agreement between God and Satan regarding the increasing pressures that have come to pass and still yet to come can be explained when Christ gave the order to gather the tears first, when Christ cracks open the seals, and also in this verse right here, in the book of Revelation 9:15, "And the four angels were loosed, which were prepared for an hour and a day and a month and a year for to slay the third part of men." Okay, so in the book of Jude 1:6 is where God imprisoned them. Why were these fallen angels in prison? They were in prison because they were responsible for that genetic mess in the days of Noah we see in Genesis 6. So it makes perfect sense that God imprisoned these fallen angels, and it is God who has loosened them, allowing these fallen angels to continue what they were doing prior to them being imprisoned. And what was that? Polluting the DNA of mankind, like it was in the days of Noah, so shall be also in the days of the coming of the Son of Man. God is giving the green light, knowing full well what is already set in the mind of Lucifer to do, ultimately to fulfill Bible prophecy and to separate the wheat from the tares, to refine God's bride, and eventually God will cut short Satan's plan to genocide every single person, because Satan's ultimate agenda is to turn every single light off that bears the signature of God, and attempt to eliminate who is currently the true light of this world, Jesus Christ. And as long as there are two or more that are gathered in his name, who remain patented and are of the offsprings of what God created, God will always remain to be the light of this world, because we all bear his patent signature. And just like Job, the abomination is designed to strip us and refine us all from the satanic system and to come out of her. Here we have a timeline mainly centered around 2017 and 2020 and 2024. Although it has many layers pointing to a specific date, remember this is based on a strong possibility. On the 20th of January 2017, the father of the abomination becomes president of America. On the 21st of August 2017, the great eclipse over the United States of America.
And it's getting dark, David. It is so spooky right now, right? The temperature is dropping, and the excitement is growing here. I hope that we're going back and forth to the special camera that has this eclipse, and I've got to put my glasses on to witness this. We've just gone completely dark, at least by the way we see it here. Oh no, still a sliver left. Is that the diamond ring? Would that be the diamond ring, perhaps? Just a sliver left. A little more. There it is.
On the 23rd of September 2017, Revelations 12 sign. On the 11th of March 2020, the WHO pandemic announcement. On the 16th of March 2020, First Woman Jennifer Haller receives an experimental jabby to ultimately achieve a jabby that would be good enough to be approved. 15th of May 2020, Operation Warp Speed is activated. On the 8th of December 2020, the first UK lady, Margaret Keenan, becomes the first worldwide to receive the approved abomination. Now we begin our journey to examine roughly when the desolation started that begins the 1290-day countdown. Let us rightly divide Daniel 12:11. Daniel 12:11. And from the time that the daily sacrifice shall be taken away, and the abomination that maketh desolate set up, there shall be 1290 days. Number 1. And from the time. Number 2. What is the daily sacrifice that is taken away? Number 3. What is the abomination that maketh desolate? Number 4. Once desolate, what are they set up for? And from the time the daily sacrifice shall be taken away. Now this gives us a clear indication of the 1290-day countdown. Okay. The answer for question 2, who is the daily sacrifice? Let's have a look. Hebrews 7:27, who needeth not daily as those high priests to offer up sacrifice first for his own sins and then for the people's? For this he did once. Who did once? Christ did once, when he offered up himself. In the book of Matthew 6:11, give us this day our daily bread. Our daily bread is Christ, and that's daily, at any time and anywhere. 1 Corinthians 15:31, I protest by your rejoicing which I have in Christ Jesus our Lord, I die daily. Okay, serving the Lord is daily. In the book of Luke 9:23, and he said to them all, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. Acts 2:47, praising God and having favor with all the people, and the Lord added to the church daily such as should be saved. We can confidently say that the churches shutting their doors when the world was in shutdown cannot be the ending of the daily sacrifice, because for one, they are apostate, and two, regardless of church closures, souls can still come to Christ at any time and anywhere. We are the church. Yes or no, Jesus Christ is that daily sacrifice. As long as someone is still breathing and genetically ripe for salvation, that daily sacrifice, salvation, is available for everyone at any time. It's called grace. Question 3. What is the abomination that makes the individual desolate? The abomination is the mark of the beetroot. Both the daily sacrifice taken away and the word desolation mean the same thing. The abomination puts an end to grace, which is the daily sacrifice, leaving the individual empty, no more grace, or desolate. Question 4. Those that have become desolate, empty, what are they set up for, sealed for, or marked for? Because this verse is saying that the abomination they make of desolate set up. So first the abomination, which is the mark of the beetroot, then the desolation. So what are the desolate set up for? Keep in mind that it's inevitable to be set up for desolation when the abomination is administered. There's a number of things that they are set up for. They are set up to keep their lifestyles. They are sealed to not have their names written in the Lamb's Book of Life. They are empty and set up to receive God's wrath. And they are set up to be also activated at some point. Let's get a rough idea how long it takes for the individual to become desolate. Day 1, the abomination is injected into the individual. Day 2, the abomination seeks to change every cell that bears the signature of God. Day 3, every cell is located. Day 4, the abomination injects CRISPR-Cas9 technology into every cell. Day 5, CRISPR-Cas9 begins to rewrite all cells. Day 6, final stage is at hand. Day 7, all cells are now patented to the name Luciferase. Later on, I will give a possible reason to why it takes a minimum of 7 days to become desolate, keeping in mind that no one knows the day or hour of every person's desolation. Only the Father, and also keep in mind that it says no man knows the day or hour. It didn't say the month or year. Throughout the Holy Scriptures, God's countdowns and timelines never failed a day late or a day early. And every time it ended, exactly on the day, something historical happened. Habakkuk chapter 2 verse 3. For the vision is yet for an appointed time, but at the end it shall speak and not lie. Though it tarry, wait for it, because it will surely come. It will not tarry. In other words, but at the end of it, it shall speak and not lie. Though leading to the end of it may tarry, but wait for it, because at the end of it, it will surely come. It will not tarry, it will not be delayed, it will be on time. Without a shadow of a doubt, the world would experience a huge biblical event at the end of that 1,290-day countdown and also the 1,335-day countdown. Now let's bring our focus back to when the 1,290-day countdown begins. Now that we have a possible idea when the individual becomes desolate, can we confidently use God's precious 1,290-day countdown starting from the WHO pandemic announcement? No, because an announcement cannot make anyone desolate. Only the abomination can make someone desolate. Did we literally see the abomination on the 11th of March 2020 as quoted by Jesus when he said, "When ye shall see the abomination"? The answer to that is no. We did not see people lining up for the abomination on the 11th of March 2020. Yes, the pandemic announcement was significant and historically felt worldwide. The pandemic announcement was just a vehicle used to instill fear upon the world, problem, response, solution, to pave the way for the abomination. Can we confidently use God's precious 1,290-day countdown, starting from the 16th of March 2020, when the first experimental subject, Jennifer Haller, took an experimental jabby? Are we to believe amongst all our government's lies surrounding this pandemic, what these experimental subjects took was 100% the actual abomination? Even though we know that this whole pandemic thing has been in the pipelines decades before the pandemic, knowing full well that Billy Goat Gruff had already succeeded in erasing the VMAT2 God gene. Are we confident to place God's precious 1,290-day countdown around what our lying governments say regarding these experimental subjects who would love to throw us off track regarding the 1,290-day countdown? Or can we trust what we all experienced in real time when we all witnessed, starting from Margaret Keenan, the first lady in the world to receive the abomination, and witnessing our very own friends and families take it, and seeing people we seen on TV lining up for miles to receive the abomination? Jesus did say, "And when ye shall see the abomination of desolation," every single eye witnessed this event. I'll choose what we all witnessed in real time over what our governments say regarding these experimental subjects anytime. Regarding the WHO pandemic announcement and the experimental subjects, we can confidently rule them out because the actual abomination that makes individuals desolate cannot begin until God gives the order to do so. Let's go to the book of Matthew 13:30. Let both grow until the harvest, and in the time of the harvest, I will say to the reapers, gather ye together first the tears, and bind them in bundles to burn them, but gather the wheat into my barn. God will say to the reapers, gather ye together first the tears. On the 15th of May 2020, under the administration of Trump, Operation Warp Speed was activated. War on mankind's genetics, all governments worldwide assigned to it. Now in the book of Revelations 12:17, it says, and the dragon was wroth with the woman and went to make war, is the key word there, with the remnant of her seed. Seed is also the key word there. Which keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. Now the rollout of the actual abomination must first begin after Jesus Christ gives the order. And now, because the 15th of May 2020 Operation Warp Speed is after the WHO pandemic announcement, and it is also after the first experimental jabber, Jennifer Haller, we can confidently rule them out because, again, the actual abomination that makes individuals desolate cannot begin until God gives the order to the reapers to first gather the tares. God's command to the reapers to first gather the tares came through the mouth of Trump. Watch part 4 to understand Operation War Seed, and watch part 1 regarding who the tares are. On the 8th of December 2020, Margaret Keenan, who was the first person in the world to receive the actual abomination, is looking more like our candidate to help us understand somewhat the kickstart of the 1290-day countdown written in the book of Daniel 12:11. On the 8th of April 2024, the United States of America will experience yet another solar eclipse, okay, roughly 7 years from the first eclipse in 2017, 7 years. Creating an X marks the spot. I will expand on this later.
Quite incredible. As the littlest, tiniest bit of the sun goes away, and we are almost literally in totality now. There it is. And at this point, we can actually look at it. Wow, you can see the light around the sun coming around the moon there. It is an incredible image to see, and the excitement from people here, everyone on their phones trying to catch a glimpse of the totality.
Now let's look at it from another verse. In the book of Daniel 9:27, it says, and he shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week, and in the midst, the key word, midst of the week, he shall cause the sacrifice and the oblations to cease, and for the overspreading of abomination, he shall make it desolate, even unto the consummation, and that determined shall be poured upon the desolate, the empty. Now verse 26 is talking about Christ, but verse 27 here, and he shall confirm a covenant with many for 1 week, the he cannot be Christ, because with Christ we have an everlasting covenant, not a 7-year covenant. So let's make that clear, and you can check that out in Hebrews 13:20, that we have an everlasting covenant. There's many verses to prove that. It's not a 7-year covenant. Keep in mind that the covenant made with many doesn't say it will be witnessed worldwide, leaving it open that it could be done in secret or deception, which would mean that we would have to think outside the box to discern. They know the majority is expecting a peace treaty, therefore it makes sense that they will deceive and toy with us, especially around the Abrahamic Accord peace deal. Again, I'm just saying a strong possibility. A possible idea outside their box, 1 week is 7 years. If we count 70 years from the announcement of Israel in 1947, that brings us to 2017. Okay. 2017 was so prophetic, we can't even ignore 2017. What happened in 2017? The father of the abomination came into power. Okay. Also, Trump's plan for peace in 2017 ultimately led to the Abrahamic Accord. And also the first eclipse over the United States. And also Revelation 12 sign in the heavens. and Jerusalem becomes the capital of Israel, and so much more. So is it possible that when the 70 year ended in 2017, did it kickstart the 7 years written in Daniel 9:27? We carry on in the verse. And in the midst of the week he shall cause the sacrifice and oblations to cease. Just like Daniel 12:11, we see here in Daniel 9:27 the same language regarding the abomination that puts an end to the daily sacrifice. But the word used here is the word ceased, which means the same thing, put an end to. So if the 7 years started in 2017, it would end in 2024. And it's in the middle of that time frame, or in the midst, just like Daniel 9:27 states, okay, it's in the middle of that time frame, somewhere grace will end for many. The daily sacrifice will be ceased. In the midpoint of their 7 year plan to genocide mankind brings us to December 2020, starting from Margaret Keenan on the 8th of December 2020, who was the first person on the earth to take the abomination and possibly the first person to be desolate. Grace no more. We carry on in the verse. And for the overspreading of abomination, he shall make it desolate even unto the consummation. In other words, overspreading of abomination means over time. Even unto the consummation, it says. The consummation, which means an action of making a covenant or marriage, in this case, can be looked at the genetic level, marrying and giving in marriage, or as CRISPR-Cas9 says, cut and paste. See part 4 teachings, for it is centered around divorcing God at the genetic level. Now the word consummation also means the point at which something is complete or finalized, okay? Think Georgia Guidestones, that they have a deadline to achieve their plan because the enemy has but a short time to achieve this. And that determined shall be poured upon the desolate. So if we put it together, it could sound something like this. In 2017, powers to be in high places agreed that in the middle or in the midst of their 7 year plan to genocide all mankind, they plan to begin to overspread the abomination, to cull and to make mankind desolate or unredeemable. And depending how good they deceive the world with their abomination, they have a set date or percentage target to jabinate mankind before they activate something that is poured into those who have become desolate, empty. Again, what will be fully activated or poured into those who are empty? That's right, grievous souls. So to find the midpoint of the 7 years spoken of in Daniel 9:27, the middle of 2017 and 2024 brings us to 2020. And in December 2020, the daily sacrifice started to cease, according to Daniel 9:27, and Daniel 12:11. So the question is, does Daniel 9:27 fit in this timeline? Now let's see if we can find a midpoint foreshadow. In the book of John 7:8-14, it says, "Go ye up unto the feast. I go not up yet unto the feast, for my time is not yet full come." When he had said these words unto them, and abode still in Galilee. When his brethren were gone up, then went he also up unto the feast, not openly, get this, but as it were in secret. Then the Jews sought him at the feast, and said, "Where is he?" Okay, we're talking about Jesus here. And there was much murmuring among the people concerning him. For some said, "He is a good man." Others said, "Nay, but he deceiveth the people." Howbeit, no man spake openly of him for fear of the Jews. Now about the midst of the feast, Jesus went up into the temple and taught.
And just as Jesus Christ came upon the feast as a thief and left in the midpoint of that feast, in the same manner he came as a thief upon those who took the abomination, then left them desolate in the midpoint between 2017 and 2024. That midpoint, which is December 2020.
Slowly they will increase the activation on those who have been set up for it. We will see this begin when the next pandemic starts. They already brainwashed the majority to start hating on those who refuse the abomination. One of many tactics they could use to increase that hatred would be to activate those who took the abomination. People around the world would see in real time strangers, family members, and friends breaking out with sores and dropping dead right in front of them. That there in itself would increase the fear, which will increase the anger at those who refuse the abomination. This deceptive event will help eliminate all doubts regarding the pandemic and totally believe it. Because never mind watching it play out on television back in early 2020, many will have front row seats and will see it play out in real time. The activation will come in stages like increasing birth pangs upon a woman. Expect a pandemic very soon. In the book of Matthew 10:21-22, and the brother shall deliver up the brother to death, and the father the child. And the children shall rise up against their parents and cause them to be put to death. And ye shall be hated of all men for my name's sake, but he that endureth to the end shall be saved.
Hi, honey.
Hey, Mom. Hey, Dad.
Hey, sweetheart.
What's the matter, Mom?
We heard on the news today that the mark is now mandatory. The government's really cracking down on the resistance. Just makes me so uneasy. But your father says not to worry.
That's right. Your mother and I are going to go down and get branded. Do you want to come?
No. I'm going to go meet up with Kristen. Dad, I'm not getting the mark.
Sweetie, you're going to have to. I mean, come on, these people are serious. You won't even be able to go out and buy food without it. Is that what you want? What are you going to do?
Dad, I don't know, but look, I'll burn that bridge when I get to it, okay? I'm not getting the mark.
You don't understand. I'm just afraid that if you don't, some harm may come to you.
Harm? Are you going to, like, turn me in?
No. Never mind about this now. Just go on and enjoy yourself with your friend.
I will.
Next! Your names, please.
Frank Holloway.
Date of birth and your ID, please.
5852.
Your name, ma'am?
Susan Holloway.
And your date of birth and your ID, please.
Yes. 9/17/54.
Is there anyone else in your home?
No. Just us.
Have a seat over there, please. You'll be called to receive your mark. Next!
Honey, are you going down to get your mark today?
No, Dad, I told you, I'm not getting the mark.
You have to. If you don't, you'll be counted as an offender. Is that what you want? If you get caught, you're going to get arrested or worse yet, killed.
Oh, honey, why can't you see what your father is trying to tell you?
Mom, why can't you see that that's the mark of Satan?
That's nonsense. Nonsense.
No, Dad, it's the truth.
No, it's not the truth.
You have the mark of the devil on your head, Dad, and I don't even want to look at you right now.
What are you, some kind of a Bible thumper all of a sudden? I'm trying to protect you.
Don't worry about me anymore. What are you doing?
Nothing. I'm just making
What is this?
It's nothing.
Mom, what is this? Did you call on me? You call on me! Don't touch me! You call on me!
Female, 5 feet, 4 inches tall, thin build.
Since the rollout of the abomination in December 2020, we are kept safe from all deceptions surrounding the abomination. Currently, over 75% were destroyed for the lack of knowledge. And very soon, the 25% that do have knowledge will be tested by their faith. Not worrying about those whose houses were made out of straw from the first wave that happened between 2020 to 2023. From today forward to the 10th of August 2024, another pandemic wave will hit. The majority of those who have not yet taken the abominations will take the abomination due to the lack of biblical sound doctrine, faith in Christ, very extreme mandates, limited food, and the black horse of the apocalypse, inflation, will make it impossible to afford keeping their lifestyles that they once had. Inflation will push many to homelessness and starvation. And like the carrot and donkey story, opportunities will arise to reward those who are struggling by tempting them to take the abomination to help ease the pain and suffering. Currently, thousands of Canadian families have no choice but to downgrade their lifestyles, and many are currently living in tents because their three jobs cannot cope with the increasing inflation. Now, the Red Horse is a spiritual war on our genetics. That's the ultimate war. A war the human eye cannot see, which is currently manifesting here on Earth as the starting of World War III. You see, it is first spiritual before it becomes literal. Just like the desolation is spiritual, the grievous sores will manifest. The more the red horse of war escalates, the more intense the pale horse, black horse, and the white horse become. These four horses are God's wrath and refining tools to help refine his bride, to separate the tears from the wheat, to gather the clusters of the vine of the earth and cast them all into the great winepress of the wrath of God. In the book of Luke 12, verse 38, and if he shall come in the second watch or come in the third watch and find them so, blessed are those servants. Blessed are those servants that know that I come like a thief, like three labor pains upon a woman when giving birth to child. The second woe has passed, and behold, the third woe comes quickly. After the second wave, the enemy grows confident. There will be less clutter for him and more clarity on a very small portion that he has to now deal with. And because they can't force us down and prick us, the only way to deal with their very small, easy to get but strong remnant is to behead them quickly. If Lucifer can gather every single person that has not yet taken the abomination and kill them, if he achieves this mission, he will succeed in eliminating Christ, who is the light of the world, which in turn would also prevent his own prophesied doom in the lake of fire. Between now and especially between the 8th of April and the 10th of August 2024, expect it to get very tough for us. It is a sweet but bitter feeling. This 106 days between each date will be our greatest testing by far. It's at this stage of beheadings God will then intervene and shorten those days, because if he didn't shorten those days, there would be no one left here on planet Earth that are genetically ripe for salvation, which in turn God will no longer be the light of this world. So in the meantime, we prepare like lambs led to the slaughter, building our faith unshakable, and to share the knowledge that we are blessed with to help edify others. In the book of John 9, verse 5, it says, "As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world." In other words, as long as there is one male or one female that can reproduce after its own kind, the patent holder and signature of Christ within mankind will continually maintain Christ to be the light of the world. Just like the enemy tried to prevent the birth of Christ in the days of Noah, this time round, the enemy cannot afford another Adam and Eve to escape his grasp this time round, because this time round, Lucifer is prophesied the lake of fire. In the book of Matthew 18, verse 20, it says, "For where two or three are gathered together in my name, there I am in the midst of them." God's signature is within our genetic makeup. In the book of Revelation 18, verse 23, it says, "And the light of the candle shall shine no more at all in thee, and the voice of the bridegroom and of the bride shall be heard no more at all in thee. For thy merchants were the great men of the earth, and by their sorceries, or pharmakia, or pharmaceuticals, were all nations deceived." In the book of Matthew 24, verse 22, "And except those days should be shortened, there should no flesh be saved, but for the elect's sake, those days shall be shortened." This is the reason why the enemy wants to turn off all the lights quickly, because he has but a short time.
They were probably sent here so that we put them in our jails, because to put them in our jails, they didn't pay the electric bill. To put them, oh, I like that much better. Oh. Oh, that's so much better. Those lights were brutal. Are they come from the dishonest press? Where? Oh, don't turn them on. Forget it. Better, right? Don't turn them on. Don't turn the lights on. Plus, we save on electricity, right? And because the lights didn't work, I won't pay the rent, so we get better lighting and we don't pay the rent, right? Right? No, get those lights off. Off! Turn them off. They're too bright. Turn them off. Turn them off. Let's go. Ready? Turn off the lights. Turn off the lights. Turn off the lights. Turn them off. So much nicer.
In the book of Revelation 12, verse 12, "Therefore rejoice, ye heavens, and ye that dwell in them. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth and by the sea, for the devil is come down unto you, having great wrath, because he knoweth that he hath but a short time." Now, to think the enemy has an extra 7 years, or even an extra 3.5 years, is to say that we have more time. It's to say that God has delayed his coming. Let's bring our focus back to the midpoint, where it is very possible when the first desolation triggered off the 1290-day countdown. Let's see if we can get ample of layers to search out this matter. If we calculate the days between the first eclipse over the United States of America from the 21st of August 2017 and the last eclipse over the United States of America on the 8th of April 2024, we come up with the number 2,422 days. How ironic that the numbers 2,422 days fit exactly between both eclipses, which activates Matthew 24, verse 22, as quote, "And except those days should be shortened, there should no flesh be saved, but for the elect's sake those days shall be shortened." If we find the midpoint or divide 2,422 by 2, we will find the number 1,211 days from the first eclipse over the United States of America on the 21st of August 2017 and exactly 1,211 days from the next eclipse over the United States on the 8th of April 2024. How ironic that this teaching is based on the Daniel 12:11 and its 1,290 day countdown. The 14th of December 2020 will be our focal point in this presentation. It's time to reveal even more layers. What happened on the 14th of December 2020? On the 14th of December 2020, Sandra Lindsay was the first American to receive the abomination. As for Margaret Keenan being the first in the world to receive the abomination on the 8th of December 2020, Margaret and others that took the abomination on the same day may have taken a minimum of 6 to 7 days to reach desolation stage, which ironically makes it somewhere on or past the 14th of December 2020. Remember, the 1,290 day countdown begins not when she took the abomination, but when she became desolate, which ultimately only the Father knows the day or hour, but keep in mind it didn't say the month or year. And how ironic that according to the scientists, it takes 1 or 2 weeks for the JV to work. Isn't it also ironic that Margaret's surname, Keenan, means possession and that the word backwards is Devok, which means in Greek, inhabited by an evil spirit. Here's another jaw dropper of yet another layer on top of many layers already. Also on the 14th of December 2020, there was a total solar eclipse over South America, which is exactly to the day in the middle, exactly 1,211 days from the eclipse over the United States on the 21st of August 2017. And exactly 1,211 days from the next eclipse over the United States on the 8th of April
2024. Y la luz avanza como si nada, y la noche llega como si nada, que lo vas a volver a repetir en el país recién en el 2048. Un eclipse solar impresionante en estos dos minutos.
Three pivotal eclipses with exactly 1,211 days in between. Let's count our layers for the date 14th of December 2020. 2,422 days between two eclipses that activates Matthew 24:22 if those days weren't shortened. Divide 2,422 days in half brings us to 1,211 days. That brings us to the midpoint date of the 14th of December 2020. It also activates Daniel 12:11, 1,290 day countdown. Sandra Lindsay, the first American person to receive the abomination on the 14th of December 2020. Margaret Keenan's Desolation transition makes it past the 14th of December 2020. An eclipse over South America on the 14th of December 2020.
A possible addition regarding the midpoint of Daniel 9:27 and John chapter 7 verse 10 to 14, when Jesus came as a thief or in secret unto the feast, then left at midpoint.
And Margaret Keenan, Keenan which means possession. So seven layers for this day. So if we count 1290 days from the 14th of December 2020, that brings us to the 26th of June 2024. On that date, I believe those who are set up, desolate and empty will be fully activated by the Revelation 16:2 vials of God's wrath that will be fully poured into those who are empty or desolate. In the book of Daniel 12:11-12, and from the time that the daily sacrifice shall be taken away, and the abomination that maketh desolate set up, there shall be 1290 days. Blessed is he that waiteth and cometh to the 1335 days. So counting 1335 days from the 14th of December 2020 brings us to the 10th of August 2024. There is a special blessing for those who endure or escape. This is where God will shorten those days spoken in Matthew 24 verse 22. God preserved the family of Eight to escape God's wrath in the days of Noah. In the same manner, he will preserve in these last days. Why? Because God will remain to be the light of the world, and the dragon will see his doom in the lake of fire. That's why.
And there were voices and thunders and lightnings, and there was a great earthquake, such as was not since men were upon the earth, so mighty an earthquake and so great. And the great city was divided into three parts, and the cities of the nations fell, and great Babylon came in remembrance before God to give unto her the cup of the wine of the fierceness of his wrath. And every island fled away, and the mountains were not found. And the great city was divided into three parts.
Where does Trump come into all this? In the meantime, Trump is gaining popularity. The more they persecute him, the more he is worshipped. Trump is currently setting his own stage. The more intense the four horsemen of the apocalypse become, the more families around the world will raise their fists at those that govern them. Truther channels are increasingly growing, and those that govern us are intentionally making themselves look bad, exposing themselves intentionally, giving these angry truther platforms more to talk about, and making these platforms help hard-working families wake up and rise, and making these hard-working families increase their anger at those that govern them, which in turn, more worship to Trump. It is a fake and orchestrated woke, purely orchestrated to lift up Trump, because to many, Trump is the only man that has the potential to crush these corrupted governments, when he himself is the head MAGA Freemason of them all. MAGA means head magician in Freemasons. It's all smokescreen, lights, camera, action. Somewhere between now and the 26th of June 2024, expect Trump to be Prime Minister again, and possibly an early election sometime before the 10th of August 2024. He could be the third US Prime Minister to govern from jail, or a green screen jail. Just like he played an important prophetic role in 2017 and 2020, so too will his up and coming role be very soon. He will go from being the father of the abomination, and very soon the father of beheadings. On the Rolling Stones magazine, Trump said that if he is re-elected, he will bring back capital punishment via firing squads and beheadings via guillotines. That's where Trump fits into all this. God is using Trump to ultimately fulfill Bible prophecy. The face of Trump and the faces of those that govern us are the faces of God's wrath upon a wicked world. So know that everything that has happened since the pandemic and around this pandemic and the pandemic yet to come, it is God who is ultimately in control of it all. So be at peace about it all. Trying to change Bible prophecy by protesting and getting upset with our corrupted governments is the same as butting heads with God himself. Be still and accept what we cannot change. Pave the way for our coming King to finally bring wrath upon this wicked generation. Not Obama, not Prince Will.i.am, and not Prince Charles even comes close to resembling Christ as Trump does to himself. No other man of our time has causeth all, both small and great, to receive the abomination like Trump did. And no other man has used so many Bible scriptures to refer to himself, even being compared to Christ or Savior of the world from others. Antichrist means in place of Christ. Not only is Trump replacing Christ by mimicking Christ, the patent name Luciferase has replaced the original patent signature of God within the temples of those who took the abomination. Now in the book of John, chapter 5, verse 43, it says, I am come in my Father's name, and ye receive me not. If another shall come in his own name, him you will receive. Many receive that patent name, that patent name which is called Luciferase.
You knew damn well I was a snake before you took me in.
Now where does the two witnesses come into all this? Before we get into this subject, let's briefly, because I've already taught in detail who the 144,000 were. Let's rightly divide the differences between who the two witnesses are and who the 144,000 are. I will provide key interest to help eliminate confusion between the two topics, and hoping to stir your curiosity to watch part 3. Let's compare Revelation 7 verse 9, the great multitude, and the 144,000 written in the book of Revelations, chapter 14, verse 1 to 5, and Revelations, chapter 7, verse 4 to 8. Revelation chapter 7 verse 9, after this I beheld, and lo, a great multitude which no man could number, of all nations and kindreds and people and tongues, stood before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes and palms in their hands. Revelation chapter 7 verse 13 to 14, and one of the elders answered, saying unto me, unto John, what are these which are arrayed in white robes, and whence come they? And I said unto him, Sir, thou knowest. In other words, John didn't know who they were. And he said to me, okay, the elder said to John, these are they which came out of the great tribulation, and have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. So the key words here are, which no man can number, and of all nations and kindreds and people and tongues, and why didn't John know who the great multitude were? Okay, in the book of Revelation, chapter 14, verse 1 to 5, and I looked, and lo, a lamb stood on the Mount Zion, and with him 144,000, having his Father's name written in their foreheads. And I heard a voice from heaven, as the voice of many waters, and as the voice of a great thunder. And I heard the voice of harpers harping with their harps. And they sung, as it were, a new song, before the throne, and before the four beasts, and the elders, and no man could learn that song but the 144,000 which were redeemed from the earth. These are they which were not defiled with woman, for they are virgins. These are they which follow the Lamb wheresoever he goeth. These are redeemed from among men, being the first fruits unto God and to the Lamb. And in their mouth was found no guile, for they are without fault before the throne of God. On part 3, I explain what the new song they sung. I explain the definition regarding they are not defiled with woman. I also explain the meaning of virgin. And also I explain what the redeemed from among men actually mean, being the first fruits, and the meaning of in their mouths were found no guile. But to keep it brief, the key words here are 144,000, a number is given, and John seems to know the 144,000 very well. In the book of Revelation, chapter 7, verse 4 to 8, talks about the 12 tribes that make up the number 144,000. Now let's rightly divide John's understanding of the great multitude and the 144,000. In the book of Revelation, chapter 1, verse 19, write the things which thou hast seen, and the things which are, and the things which shall be hereafter. So God tells John to write down what he has experienced, things that are current in his life, and things that is yet to come. Now consider both the great multitude and the 144,000. The great multitude no man could number versus 144,000, a number that can be numbered. The great multitude are people from all nations, kindreds, and different languages, versus the 144,000 that are specifically from the 12 tribes of Israel, that are from one specific nation who have one language. And also, John didn't know who the great multitude were, versus John knew in detail who the 144,000 were, what tribes they came from, what gospel or song they preached, and John knew the exact number that make up the 12 tribes of Israel, that number being 144,000. So regarding the great multitude and the 144,000, without a shadow of doubt, these two topics are butting heads with each other and not making sense. Siren bells should be going off in your heads that these two topics are not the same. When John was told to write down what he experienced, did he write down what he experienced regarding the 144,000? That being past tense? Because we do understand that the great multitude is a futuristic event. This is enough information in itself for anyone that has common sense to reevaluate what they thought, merging both together, the 144,000 and the great multitude being the same thing. Overall, I strongly believe, based on these huge contradictions between the two subjects, that the 144,000 and the great multitude is without a shadow of doubt not the same. The 12 tribes of Israel, or the 144,000, as quoted in scripture, are the first fruits. In the book of Romans, chapter 11, verse 16, "For if the first fruit be holy, the lump is also holy, and if the root be holy, so are the branches." The Jews that accepted the new covenant laws had to get the new covenant laws right. No guile. Holy, because if the gospel is without flaw, the Gentiles would also receive a flawless gospel. The gospel had to come first to the Jews, and then the Gentiles. The Gentiles are grafted in the book of Romans, chapter 11, verse 17. "And if some of the branches be broken off, and thou, being a wild olive tree, wert grafted in among them, and with them partakest of the root and fatness of the olive tree." So the wild olive tree are the Gentiles. It's because of the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, the partition wall between the Jews and Gentiles was pulled down. Watch part 5 to understand why the Mosaic partition wall was put there in the first place. In the book of Romans, chapter 11, verse 24, "For if thou wert cut out of the olive tree, which is wild by nature," okay, he's talking about the Gentiles here, "and wert grafted contrary to the nature into a good olive tree," okay, that good olive tree is Christ, "how much more shall these, which be the natural branches, be grafted into their own olive tree?" Okay, so the Jews and Gentiles were grafted into the olive tree of Christ. Now let's look at another subject here, the times, times, and half a time. In the book of Revelation 13, verse 5, "And there was given unto him a mouth speaking great things and blasphemies, and power was given unto him to continue 42 months. There's only one that stands out to be that most boastful and blasphemous of our time, Trump. Although it seems that his presidency had ended on the 20th of January 2021, according to this verse, he is still pulling the strings behind the scenes, and very soon he will be prime minister again. In the book of Revelations 12, verse 14, "And to the woman were given two wings of a great eagle, that she might fly into the wilderness, into her place, where she is nourished for a time, times, and half a time from the face of the serpent." Counting a time, times, and half a time, or 3.5 years starting from December 2020, our nourishment and protection will expire. Satan's desire to actually put his hands on us and hunt us down will then follow. In the book of Revelation, chapter 11, verse 1 to 14, "And there was given me a reed like unto a rod, and the angel stood, saying, Rise and measure the temple of God and the altar, and them that worship therein. But the court which is without the temple leave out, and measure it not, for it is given unto the Gentiles, and the holy city shall they tread under foot 42 months. Okay, the holy city that is treaded under foot for 42 months could symbolize the rolling out of the abomination upon the world, starting from December 2020. And the court, which is without the temple to leave out and not measure, could be symbolic for those temples that have received the abomination. Verse 3, and I will give power unto my two witnesses, and they shall prophesy 1,260 days, clothed in sackcloth. From the rolling out of the abomination in December 2020, God has given us a small window time frame of 1,260 days or 42 months to get things right with Him, to understand the current correct timeline we are in, what the abomination is, to build our faith unshakable, and to help edify, correct, and teach those that are not aware. Sackcloth and ashes were an outward sign of mourning, repentance, or abasement. Although the meaning of sackcloth means a time of reflecting and repentance, it also is a time to mourn for those who have succumbed the abomination. Sackcloth could also mean one relying on God in a desert. Like Moses, Job, and John the Baptist, an individual that is currently being stripped of all that he has. And because a lot of us didn't take the abomination, many of us lost their businesses, jobs, family, houses, friendships, less money, and less food. Many of us have downgraded our lifestyles, and some are even living in tents, including myself. Some are fortunate, and some are not as fortunate. But eventually, none will be fortunate. And both, fortunate and less unfortunate, will be in the same boat. This could be the symbolic meaning behind the word sackcloth. Symbolically, it could sound like this. We used to wear fancy clothes to now wearing sackcloth. We used to admire our comfortable lives to now preparing our lives to be tough. Verse 4. These are the two olive trees and the two candlesticks standing before the God of the earth. Okay, the two olive trees. Remember, the Jews and Gentiles were grafted in. They're described as the two olive trees. Not only did John the Baptist have the spirit of Elias, likewise, we too have the boldness and characteristics of Elias and Moses and of all inspired men who were used by God. Verse 5, and if any man will hurt them, fire proceedeth out of their mouth and devoureth their enemies. And if any man will hurt them, he must in this manner be killed. The fire that comes out of our mouths is the word of God, helping to edify, correct, and to teach those who are double-minded regarding the times we live in. In the book of Jeremiah, chapter 5, verse 14, wherefore thus saith the Lord God of hosts, because ye speak this word, behold, I will make my words in thy mouth fire, and this people would, and it shall devour them. Okay, so those that scoff at us and delay his coming, the Lord of that scoffer will come upon him like a thief and cut him asunder. He must in this manner be killed. Verse 6. These have power to shut heaven that it rain not in the days of their prophecy, and have power over waters to turn them to blood and to smite the earth with all plagues as often as they will. Okay, so just like the Pharisees had power to shut up the kingdom of heaven against men, we see in the book of Matthew 23 verse 13, in other words, the Pharisees would threaten those and make it very difficult for those to follow the gospel of Christ. We too have the power to also choose who we can edify and who not to edify. Those who have taken the abomination, we don't waste our time on. We shut up the kingdom of heaven to those who have taken the abomination. This couldn't be possible without the abomination, because prior to the abomination, the gospel was for all. Nothing, no rain, no church closures, and no internet access will stop us from edifying and educating others until that 42 months is up. We have the power over waters to turn them into blood and to smite the earth with all plagues as often as we'd like, because as long as the two witnesses are still living that bear the light of Jesus Christ before their 42 months is up, prophecy will continue on as it is written. Verse 7, and when they shall finish their testimony, the beast that ascendeth out of the bottomless pit shall make war against them, and shall overcome them and kill them. If our ability to edify, warn, and witness to each other came to a sudden halt via no more access to the world internet, we can still edify, warn, and teach in person. Absolutely nothing can stop us from witnessing and shining the light of Christ. Only death. That's where verse 8 comes in. Verse 8. And their dead bodies shall lie in the street of the great city, which is spiritually is called Sodom in Egypt, where also our Lord was crucified. Okay, Sodom in Egypt is now worldwide. Verse 9. And they of the people and kindreds and tongues and nations shall see their dead bodies 3 days and a half, and shall not suffer their dead bodies to be put in graves. And they that dwell upon the earth shall rejoice over them and make merry, and shall send gifts one to another, because these two prophets tormented them that dwelt on the earth. And after 3 days and a half, the Spirit of life from God entered into them, and they stood upon their feet, and great fear fell upon them which saw them. Not if, but when Trump is elected back into Parliament, not only will he bring back capital punishment via firing squad and beheadings, Trump states himself that he will also televise these executions for the whole world to see. The embodiment of Lucifer's bride, who are now patented and genetically owned by Lucifer, will applaud the executions of those who choose Jesus Christ over the abomination. In the book of Revelations, chapter 20, verse 4, and I saw thrones, and they sat upon them, and judgment was given unto them. And I saw the souls of them that were beheaded for the witness of Jesus and for the word of God, and which had not worshipped the beast, neither his image, neither had received his mark upon their foreheads and in their hands, and they lived and reigned with Christ 1,000 years. Starting from 2017, it is here in 2024 that ends the 7 years. So this time frame highlighted right here seems to be our final stages of the end of the age. It is also here where we see the last eclipse over the United States on the 8th of April 2024. It is also starting from the 14th of December 2020. It is also here when the 42-month protection countdown over the two witnesses expire on the 14th of June 2024. It is also somewhere here we will see that great city be split into three parts. Starting from the 14th of December 2020, it is also here that the 1,290-day countdown ends on the 26th of June 2024. Starting from when Trump's presidency ended on the 20th of January 2021, it is also here we see the ending of Trump's extra 42-month reign behind the scenes and soon to be in front of the scenes. That expires on the 20th of July, 2024. Starting from the date 14th of December, 2020, it is also here we see the 1,335-day countdown expire on the 10th of August, 2024. keeping in mind that the 14th of December 2020 is a possibility, because no one knows the hour or day of the first desolation, and because no one knows the day or hour, we could use the month of December 2020, and if we count the 42 months, 1,290 days, the time times and half a time, and the 1,335 day countdown, the expiry date of all of it will still end in this bracket in 2024.
Remember therefore how thou hast received and heard, and hold fast and repent. If therefore thou shalt not watch, I will come on thee as a thief. And thou shalt not know what hour I will come upon thee. The Lord of that servant shall come in a day when he looketh not for him, and in an hour that he is not aware of, and shall cut him asunder, and appoint him his portion with the hypocrites. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth.